Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. And the first portfolio is Wellbeing Economy, Net Zero and Energy. I would remind members if they would wish to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question or indicate so by entering the letters RTS in the chat function if online. And at question number one, I call Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of its reasons for the removal of its annual and interim targets for carbon emissions.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
As the member is aware, the Scottish Government proposed a 70% target for 2030 in the 2019 Act, and it was a Scottish Labour amendment, of course, that proposed that 75% reduction, which the Climate Change Committee advised was likely unachievable. And while the cross-party ambition of Parliament was clear, there is no doubt that Parliament understood the scale of the challenge. The Climate Change Committee has now firmly assessed that the target for 2030 is not feasible, which we accept in the challenging context of UK cuts and backtracking. Our current rigid linear annual target approach is not fit for purpose, poorly reflecting realities like harsher winters, and does not allow precision when estimating impact of developing technologies.
Katie Clark.
In 2020, the UK Climate Change Committee wrote to the Scottish Government saying the interim targets were difficult but not impossible to achieve and outlining what needed to be done to achieve them. Does the Minister not accept that the action needed was not taken, but also that now we need to set out a plan to achieve the maximum reductions and set out targets given the climate emergency and the impact this has on humanity?
Minister.
Well, it is really important we all do work together to look at the impact on humanity and make sure this Parliament hopefully can unite around the measures required to reduce emissions and achieve our overall net zero targets in Scotland. And I think we can all agree on that. All members are obviously aware that often when some of the proposals come forward, suddenly political bandwagons are created and parties jump onto them, and there's political opposition to some of the measures we do have to take to reduce emissions in Scotland. It could be low emission zones, it could be deposit return schemes. There's a whole host of issues in my time in Parliament that the government's put forward and opposition parties oppose. So therefore, it's very difficult to make progress under these circumstances. We have to unite where possible and move forward with these long-term targets and with our carbon budgets, which of course the rest of the UK follow, and work together to achieve those ambitions.
Question number two, Marie McNair.
To ask the Scottish Government how its long-term labour market strategy is helping to make Scotland a fairer country.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While employment law remains reserved to the UK Government, we are promoting fairer work practices across the labour market in Scotland. Despite challenging conditions, the latest labour market statistics demonstrate positive progress on labour market inequalities, including the gender pay gap and the disability employment gap. Our approach to employability aims to tackle inequalities in Scotland's labour market by creating a system that meets the needs of employers and helps people of all ages who experience barriers to participating in Scotland's labour market to achieve their potential. And our skills system will support these ambitions as we take the lead on national skills planning while strengthening regional approaches.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Conservative Party have accused people of over-medicalising everyday challenges and worries of life. And this is from an extremely financially privileged individual who has never had to experience the worry and adversity that his party has forced on people up and down Scotland. Can I ask the Minister how this SNP Scottish Government intends to continue protecting people from the worst abuses of Tory mismanagement?
Minister.
I would just like to say to Minnie McNair that I know exactly the reference that she was making. I was appalled by the language used by the Prime Minister. He talked about a sick note culture alongside an anti-workers' right, anti-trade union agenda, which does nothing to support people accessing the labour market, neither employers with recruitment and retention. By contrast, we in Scotland treat people with fairness, dignity and respect by developing a wellbeing economy and tackling structural inequalities. As I said, this means promoting fairer work practices across the labour market in Scotland through our approach to employability, meeting the needs of employers and helping people of all ages who experience barriers and working together to take those barriers down.
And supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A fundamental part of the Scottish Government's labour market strategy and fair work policy is the promotion of the real living wage. And I know the Scottish Government wants all those who are engaging in procurement with Scottish Government to pay the real living wage. When members of this Parliament's Economy and Fair Work Committee visited Prestwick Airport last week, an institution wholly owned by Scottish ministers, we were horrified to find out that that institution does not pay the real living wage. So when the minister talks about fairness, dignity and respect for workers, should she not begin at home?
Minister.
Obviously, I wasn't on that visit to Prestwick Airport, and Murdo Fraser raises something which I will feed back to the Cabinet Secretary and officials, because obviously I have to investigate that. We need to investigate ourselves.
I call question number 3, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government regarding its work to secure a sustainable future for Ferguson Marine, what discussions the Net Zero Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding potential plans for a direct award of the small vessel replacement programme contract to Ferguson Marine.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
As ministers have advised Parliament previously, a direct award of public contracts is possible only in strict, limited circumstances under public procurement rules. So ministers are currently evaluating the business case for the small vessel replacement programme, and all ministers with a portfolio interest in the programme are connected to that in the normal way.
Graeme Simpson.
Before he was cruelly dumped, the former CEO, David Tideman, produced a series of investment asks of the government which could secure the yard's future. Now, this business plan went to the Cabinet Secretary, unfortunately not here today, on April the 5th. So how much is the minister prepared to invest to upgrade the yard, and does he foresee it getting any government contracts soon?
Minister.
Well, as the member, I'm sure, is also aware, ministers have also informed Parliament that they are currently considering the business case for further investment, and that's an ongoing process within the government, and that ministers are committed to updating Parliament as soon as there's any progress with that or any news to give to MSPs in Parliament. So it's something, of course, we're taking seriously. We want to do everything we can to support the jobs going forward. But clearly, we have to consider the business case that has been put forward, and Parliament will be updated in due course.
Supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister has said that a direct award is, under procurement rules, possible only in strictly limited circumstances. Can he say what those circumstances are, and has the Scottish Government spoken to UK counterparts to ascertain whether the UK Government would support a direct order, or if the Subsidy Control Act would come into play, and when will we have a final decision on the award of this contract?
Minister.
Well, the procurement law requirements in which a contract can be directly awarded are set out in the Public Contracts Scotland Regulations of 2015. And the question of subsidy control compliance, of course, also has to be considered separately. Our consideration of a direct award has to date not necessitated engagement with the UK Government. Of course, that may arise. I can't predict what the case will be. And as I said to the previous member, ministers are currently considering the issues and will update Parliament accordingly.
And supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister refers to the subsidy control regime restricting potential state aid for investment at Ferguson Marine, but has he considered that one of the key asks in the investment plan is a new panel line, yet there are already two existing panel lines in Scotland, in Govan and in Rosyth, as well as a third being installed currently in Belfast? Has he considered that a way around this restriction is to actually take a sector-wide approach and pool the resources available in shipbuilding steelwork across Scotland to draw on it for Ferguson Marine's future programmes?
Minister.
Well, I'll certainly draw the member's point to the attention of the Cabinet Secretary, and I'm sure that will be taken into account. And, of course, all the issues at the moment are being considered. But, of course, as I said before, there are a number of specific issues that have to be considered in terms of the business case, and Parliament will be updated in due course.
Question number 4, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Energy Minister has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any support it provides to communities opposing onshore wind farm developments at public inquiries.
Minister Gillian Martin.
The onshore wind sector deal in Scotland sets out that onshore wind will continue to collaborate with local communities, building good practices to enhance an existing good neighbour approach through engagement at all stages of the project life cycle, offering impactful community benefits and practical routes to shared ownership. I can confirm I have no discussions with ministerial colleagues regarding live applications. Scottish ministers have been fully cooperating with the Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee regarding a live petition seeking to increase the ability of communities to influence planning decisions for onshore wind farms.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The current process is far from fair or equitable, with local communities and residents facing aggressive and humiliating questioning from legal representatives desperate to deliver consent for their clients. Worse still, useful video evidence from past inquiries showing such behaviour has been removed and prevents scrutiny and denies new objectors the chance to familiarise themselves with the likely process. Does the Minister agree that local communities deserve legal representation when it's clearly a combative process? And will she ask the DPEA to look again at the decision to remove videos from their website?
Minister.
Thank Oliver Mundell for that. It's an issue that he has raised a couple of times in the Chamber, and I have been obviously aware of some of the issues that he's said that people have faced. And obviously, I go back to the petition. The ask in the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to appoint an independent advocate to ensure that local participants are not bullied or intimidated at public local inquiries. Reporters are, however, instructed to ensure that unrepresented partners are able to give their evidence in a safe environment. Where unrepresented parties are appearing at an inquiry, reporters confirm at the outset of the inquiry it's important that witnesses are treated courteously at all times, and especially when being cross-examined. And if any witness feels bullied or intimidated by the tone of cross-examination, they are advised to inform the reporter immediately.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the same vein, I have met with many concerned constituents near Newton Stewart and D&G who have concerns about proposed wind farm developments in Glenvernach and Blair Hill, which would see the tallest turbine height in Scotland onshore, despite the region already having one of the highest levels of wind farm developments anywhere in Scotland. I know the Minister cannot comment on live planning applications, but can she outline further what action constituents can take to ensure that the proposers adequately hear concerns and engage diligently with persons opposing developments?
Minister.
Well, I can confirm that applications for both proposals that Emma Harper has mentioned there have not been yet submitted to Scottish ministers. But she is right that even before that point, I can't comment on the merit or otherwise. If a proposed development proceeds to an application stage, there are clear notification requirements to ensure that local communities and the general public are informed of submission to Scottish ministers. Members of the public may make representations and comment to the Scottish ministers on the applications. When an application is ready to be determined, Scottish ministers consider all relevant material available to them before making any decision. But I would implore the developers to have meaningful engagement with the constituents of Mr Mundell and Emma Harper on all their proposals well ahead of that process.
Question number 5, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what discussions it has had with Petronius and trade unions about refining capacity at Grangemouth.
Minister Julian Martin.
Thank Daniel Johnson for that question. The Scottish Government continues to engage extensively with Petroineos, and I most recently met Petroineos CEOs on the 27th of March and made clear the Scottish Government's commitment to continue to engage constructively with the business. Petroineos and the unions are also member of the GFIB Leadership Forum, which I convened on the 28th of March. Ministers met with Unite and the STUC on the morning of the import terminal announcement. And out with the Grangemouth Future Industries Board, I met with unions at a Just Transition Commission roundtable in Falkirk on the 15th of March, which had representation from the wider Grangemouth community, Petroineos themselves, unions and the local authority, and I'll next meet Unite in June to further discuss this very important matter.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that detailed answer, but here's what I think we know. The most recent accounts from Petroineos show that the site is profitable. It has now secured investment in the hydrocracker, which was previously seen to be critical, and yet the plan to stop refining in 2025 is still in place. So can the Minister confirm What is her understanding about what factors motivate this commitment to disinvestment? Has it discussed these matters with PetroChina directly, given that the government has met with them and they are bankrolling much of this, or indeed any other potential investors? But most critically, is the government's objective to secure refining beyond 2025 on Grangemouth, or simply to mitigate the decisions being made elsewhere?
Minister.
Now, Mr Johnson raises really important points. I mean, I have to point to the fact that these are commercial decisions that are making at PetroEnias, and they have actually outlined them. I don't think it's fair to air them in public about what their commercial and decisions have been based on, because I think that's confidential. But certainly one of the key aims of this government working in partnership with the UK government and indeed the Grangemouth wider community is to see how we can secure the refinery for the future. One of the things that we're very keen to look at is it becoming a biorefinery. We're looking at ways in which we can influence UK government to perhaps bring down the HEFA cap so that they can look at maybe being one of the first movers in sustainable aviation fuel. I think that's one of the areas in which there really is an opportunity for the refinery, and actually our colleagues at PetroEnias agree with that very much, and that's very much something we're working towards.
And supplementary, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister provide further information on how plans to develop a specific just transition plan for the Grangemouth industrial cluster will help secure a long-term sustainable future for the area?
Minister.
Our just transition plan for the Grangemouth industrial cluster will outline a first-of-its-kind vision for the site, outlining the long-term net zero operations we would hope to see take place by 2045, some of which I mentioned to Daniel Johnson. Beyond this, our plan will also chart a series of actions that seek to secure this, focusing on securing long-term investment, developing technical and commercially viable solutions for manufacturing, the required policy development, as well as the skills and place-based activity required to support a prosperous net zero future for the area. This plan is being developed with those working in Grangemouth, with the communities, local employers, local authority, unions and many other stakeholders.
Question number six, Craig Coy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what due diligence is conducted by Home Energy Scotland when selecting recommended suppliers to install energy efficiency improvements that are supported by Scottish Government funding.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Home Energy Scotland is not responsible for selecting or recommending installers of energy efficient improvements, but applicants to the Home Energy Scotland grant and loan scheme are required to use an MCS accredited installer for heat pumps and other renewables, and a Trustmark registered installer for complex energy efficiency measures, including external wall insulation. HES recommends for all measures that households contact at least three installers, ensure the chosen installer is fully qualified, and seek a guarantee or warranty for the work carried out.
Craig Coy.
Across Scotland, many colleges are saying that they are unable to recruit enough apprentices in order to be able to meet the demand that is forthcoming in order to deliver on the government's insulation plans and the net zero objectives. Will she therefore speak to the Further Education Minister to reverse funding cuts to Scotland's councils, which will only mean there will be more cowboy operators operating in government-funded schemes in Scotland?
Yeah. Minister.
Tell Mr Hoy exactly what we're doing. We're working in partnership with the sector to ensure that appropriate support and training provision are aligned at local level with business needs and local demands. We've funded the Green Heat Installer Engagement Programme to provide assistance and support for installers in their clean heat transition, becoming accredited for the installation of heat pumps. And this included the MCS Certification Fund, which last year supported 24 businesses to become MCS certified. It is actually an issue that is of great importance. I have frequent conversations with Graeme Day, who's in charge of obviously what the overseeing what the colleges do. They are very alive to the fact that there are a number of streams of skills where they're going to have to really up their game in terms of actually producing a prospectus that's going to meet the demands for future skills.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Energy Savings Trust administer the grant and loan scheme for Home Energy Scotland. I've heard from suppliers about delays in processing applications, and the knock-on effect is that delayed payments to the businesses negatively impacts their cash flow. So while ensuring due diligence, what can the Scottish Government do to improve the process so local suppliers, which are often small businesses, can continue to support the ongoing and necessary energy efficiency installations?
Minister.
Well, our target is to always process applications of Home Energy Scotland claims within 10 working days once in receipt of the required documentation. We're very aware that the majority of those applications are actually delivered on time. But of course, obviously, a lot more can be done as we're rolling out this scheme to make sure that if there's any delays to anything, that's investigated and we develop processes. Well, they develop processes in place that improve on that.
Question number 7, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact it anticipates its recent announcements on changes to its net zero targets will have on the development of a green economy.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
The need to amend the statutory trajectory targets towards our ambitious net zero targets is driven by legal necessity, and it follows all parties setting a target which was considered beyond what could be reasonably achieved, and our recent announcements in no way detract from the scale of our ambitions for tackling climate change, including via our energy transition, which presents enormous economic opportunities for Scotland, as well as the risks that have to be managed, of course. And we remain committed to realising those opportunities in Scotland for our businesses and workers and supporting a just transition.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Nuclear Industry Association has warned that Scotland's green economy risks losing billions in investment thanks to the SNP's short-sighted opposition to new nuclear developments. Now that the Greens are no longer in government, will the Minister use this opportunity to consider nuclear power as a means of bolstering Scotland's green economy and strengthening energy security?
Minister.
Only a Tory could intervene and call for more attention and focus on nuclear when Scotland's in the middle of a green energy revolution in terms of jobs from offshore winds. Can I draw members' attention to the P&J from around a week ago, where Ian Wood said this decision in terms of the offshore floating wind farm that was given consent, this decision will unlock around £3 billion of investment, generate hundreds of jobs and will effectively result in Europe's first commercially scaled floating wind development. This is phenomenal developments happening across Scotland at the moment. Let's not waste time and resources on decades of lost opportunity focusing on nuclear when we've got this opportunity on our doorstep that's happening right now before our eyes. Let's create the jobs and green energy and power ourselves towards net zero.
Supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To deliver a just transition, we need to make sure that Scotland's workforce have the skills needed by industry. So for workers in the oil and gas sector, approximately 80% of their skills could be used in renewables, but demonstrating those skills is a challenge. That's why we support the development of an energy skills passport, but it's been delayed and delayed. The former Minister for Green Skills said a passport would be delivered this April. April has gone and no announcement. Yeah. So will the Minister intervene urgently, work with trade unions, industry and skills accreditation companies to get a passport in place as soon as possible to open those opportunities up for those workers in Scotland?
Minister.
The Energy Skills Passport, of course, is a key building block to getting towards the just transition, and it's something a lot of resource and time has been devoted to from ministers. But, of course, it's an industry-led initiative. It's, of course, been quite complex, as the members are aware. And the good news is we're expecting, hopefully, an announcement soon, so we'll hear about the progress that is being made. But, of course, it's industry-led. It is an important initiative, and, as I said before, it's something we have devoted resources towards because of its importance.
And brief supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. Does the Minister agree with me that it's somewhat hypocritical of the Conservatives to be demanding more investment in net zero when the Conservative government has cut our capital budget?
Minister.
John Mason, of course, makes a perfectly valid and powerful point. It is hypocritical for the Conservatives to cut Scotland's capital budgets at a time when we've got the climate emergency and we want to address it and invest in the green energy revolution.
Members, please.
And then come here and complain about the lack of progress towards those targets. It's utter hypocrisy.
And question number 8, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on hospitality and other businesses in Scotland of new post-Brexit import fees on food products known as the Common User Charge.
Minister Richard Lougheed.
The UK Government recently published its common user charge fees for government-run border control posts in England. Currently, there are no government-run BCPs in Scotland. However, it is anticipated this charge sets a market price signal, and clearly Scots traders using English ports will be affected. We will, of course, monitor any impacts on businesses and consumers, including, of course, those in our very important hospitality sector.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Minister for that response. Household budgets across Scotland have been decimated by the cost of living crisis, Liz Truss's mini-budget and Brexit, and now people are facing fees of up to £145 on items like fish, cheese and yoghurt. What steps are the Scottish Government taking with the powers it has to mitigate these harms being inflicted on the people of Scotland?
Minister.
Well, I heard the Conservative members sighing when the member mentioned the impact of UK government policies on hospitality businesses in Scotland. And I would remind them that the Business Insight survey says that the top factors affecting businesses in Scotland are inflation and energy costs, both of which are at the door of the UK government at the moment.
Cabinet Secretary, please resume your seat for a wee second. I won't have all this shouting across the chamber. The Minister has been asked a question. He is responding. Please have the courtesy to listen to his response. Minister.
But Colette Stevenson is quite right. Of course, recent press reports have highlighted concerns increasing costs will lead to a further price increase for consumers already struggling with the cost of living crisis. This, of course, is entirely because of Brexit. And it's entirely because of Brexit this latest raft of import controls has been introduced. And it's Brexit that Scotland didn't vote for, but we're paying a huge price, and no one can point to the benefits of Brexit. But this is yet more unnecessary damage being caused to the Scottish economy from it.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, net zero and energy. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio to allow frontbench teams to change position should they so wish. Thank you. Thank you. So the next portfolio is Finance, Deputy First Minister Responsibilities and Parliamentary Business. Again, should a member wish to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function if online during the relevant question. I call question number one, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on when its review of capital spending will be complete.
Deputy First Minister Shona Robinson.
The capital outlook is currently very challenging, with a 9% real terms cut in our capital funding from UK Government. Work is underway to update the infrastructure pipeline to ensure that it is affordable, deliverable and provides the best value for money.
Rhoda Grant.
In the Highlands, a number of health projects have been paused. The maternity services upgrade, the new Belford Hospital for Fort William and the Caithness Health redesign. So all the while the construction costs are increasing while this pause and delay is in place. And that's adding greater costs to the investment, but it's also creating greater costs for the NHS Highland because they're having to manage that failing infrastructure. Can I ask when the review will be complete and what will be the value of the projects that get the go-ahead and what will be the value of the projects scrapped?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, first of all, can I say to Rhoda Grant that I do understand very much the issues that she is raising, but given the not just the cut to our capital budget, but of course the significant levels of construction inflation that has resulted in a reduction in our spending power on top of that capital cut has meant we had no other choice than to revisit the pipeline of projects. That work, as I have said to Rhoda Grant in this chamber before, is underway to review the programmes relating to the 2021 Infrastructure Investment Plan, as I said in my initial answer, to ensure it's affordable, deliverable and provides value for money. The refreshed infrastructure pipeline is intended to be published alongside the medium-term financial strategy, as it's right that future investment plans are embedded in wider thinking on fiscal sustainability. And that, of course, will include the reference to the health projects that Rhoda Grant mentioned in her question.
Supplementary, Alec Riley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Bus Partnership Fund has been paused despite local transport authorities spending a lot of time and money working up bids worth hundreds of millions of pounds that are clearly linked to the government strategy for hitting net zero and getting people out of cars and onto public transport. So how will the government prioritise, and can the Cabinet Secretary give an indication of when the Bus Partnership Fund will resume?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, of course, first of all, the Bus Partnership Fund sits within the Transport Secretary's portfolio, but clearly the support for the expansion of public transport is a key lever in our ambitions towards net zero. In terms of the prioritisation that Alex Rowley referred to, the work that is going on, not just in the infrastructure investment pipeline, but across the whole of government in terms of the capital priorities in the light of the construction costs inflation that I mentioned, the cut to our capital budget, but also the further cut to financial transaction availability, has meant we have had to make very difficult decisions, but also look to prioritise, and that work is underway. And of course, when new First Minister comes into post, I'm sure they will also have a view on those priorities.
And supplementary, Peter Swishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 2 weeks ago, I asked the Cabinet Secretary for Health when we might know more about the timetable to replace Shetland's Gilbert Bain Hospital. He acknowledged that certain parts of the 1950s design building are in a bad state. In light of the capital spending review, and as the Gilbert Bain Hospital is one of the oldest buildings in the Highlands and Islands, will the Deputy First Minister do all she can to ensure that progress towards a replacement hospital is forthcoming?
Deputy First Minister.
I will ask the Health Secretary to write to Beatrice Wishart, but I think really what I said to Rhoda Grant in terms of that infrastructure investment pipeline, the reasons that we are having to revisit that, which are multifaceted, the rise in construction costs, the cuts to capital budget, will apply to all of these projects. But I do understand both Beatrice Wishart's point and that of Rhoda Grant that giving certainty as early as possible is very important, and that's why the refreshed pipeline will be published alongside the medium-term financial strategy.
Question number two, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on work undertaken to resolve any public sector equal pay disputes.
Deputy First Minister.
The Scottish Government has a long-standing commitment to the principles of fair work, and the Fair Work Action Plan outlines the direct action we're taking to address labour market inequalities. All public bodies and local authorities need to ensure they comply with their legal obligations and are encouraged to work jointly with their trade unions in undertaking equal pay reviews and equality proofing their pay systems.
Maggie Chapman.
The Cabinet Secretary for that response, sorry, the Deputy First Minister for that response. Pay discrimination appears to be endemic in local government. The GMB union has active equal pay cases in six local authorities, including Dundee. Job evaluation is an ongoing issue in Glasgow, and a local authority contracting company used by Dundee, Angus and Perth and Kinross councils uses discriminatory practices. Today is May Day, International Workers' Day. Will the Deputy First Minister agree to meet with the GMB union to discuss the issues their members are facing and to support the development of a strategy to deal with pay discrimination in local government?
Deputy First Minister.
First of all, let me thank Maggie Chapman for raising what are important issues. She, of course, will be aware that As councils are independently accountable bodies and employers, it is their duties to ensure compliance with the Equality Act 2010. We recognise the need to move forward on these issues. Of course, our negotiation and ongoing dialogue with trade unions is important to us. But we have to ensure that where it is contractual and employment-related issues, that that has to remain an issue between the trade unions and the respective employer local authorities in this case. We, of course, recognise the importance of local government funding within that context and them being able to take the steps that they need to resolve some of the equal pay claims. And with that in mind, of course, that's why the 2024-25 Scottish Budget provides record funding for local government of over £14 billion, a record real terms increase of 2.5%. But I would be happy to further discuss with Maggie Chapman the issues if she would like to do so.
Supplementary, Michael Mara.
Officer, and I welcome the response from the Deputy First Minister regarding the compliance on these issues. What would you say to the leader of Dundee City Council, who continually refuses to meet with the GMB union or, frankly, answer correspondence from parliamentarians on this exact issue around the pay dispute? And can I draw the Chamber's attention to my declaration of interest as a member of the GMB?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, first of all, let me say that I know the leader of Dundee City Council takes these matters very seriously indeed and values very much the relationship with the trade unions. I would just remind Michael Mara that, of course, in relation to one of the biggest equal pay claims in the city of Glasgow, it took a change of administration from Labour to the SNP to begin to resolve these matters. So there is no lack of willingness and desire to resolve equal pay claims on the part of the Scottish National Party, whether that's in local government or anywhere else.
Thank you. I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers because we've still got quite a number of questions to get through. Question number three, Sue Webber.
Hopefully I'll help with that, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reports that local government debt has now risen to 160% of its annual funding settlement.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
While there are no limits on the amount a Scottish local authority can borrow, local authorities are under a statutory duty to determine and keep under review the maximum amount which it can afford to allocate to capital expenditure, including associated borrowing levels. Local authorities must have regard to SIPFA Prudential Code, which requires borrowing to be affordable, prudent and sustainable. Regulations also require a local authority to set an authorised limit for external debt.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Minister. Given the shocking rise of local government debt and the risk of this to spiral further, can you confirm what contingency plans the Scottish Government has made in the event of a local authority going bankrupt?
Minister.
I thank the member for her question. Obviously, it is not possible for the kind of cuts which have come to our capital budget from the UK government and for there not to be an impact on capital borrowing if we want to continue doing some of the services. But when we're talking about councils going bankrupt, there have been no councils in Scotland who have gone bankrupt, and the latest report suggested there were none likely to. That's a huge contrast to Conservative-controlled England, where there have been 12 Section 114 notices in 8 councils. And these are not just Labour councils, Presiding Officer. We've got Nottingham City Council twice, Croydon Borough Council, Slough Borough Council, Nottingham City Council, Croydon Borough Council again, Northumberland Council, Croydon Borough Council again, Thurrock Council, Woking Borough Council, Birmingham Council and most recently Nottingham City Council. So, Presiding Officer, this Government will keep doing what we can to support and work with our local authorities. I think the UK Government should start doing the same to their local authorities.
Supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. I wonder if the Minister would say anything about the private finance initiative and the public private partnerships, which put local authorities under huge pressure and impacted their debt.
Yeah. Minister.
John Mason makes a very strong point. PFI was an expensive Labour and Tory mistake that simply did not deliver best value for the people of Scotland. PFI PPP unitary payments place significant pressure on local authorities. Presiding Officer, there are 38 local authority PFI contracts. Up to £7.25 billion in payments on these contracts have been made up to this year, with a further £8.15 billion in payments payments to be made over the coming year. That's £15.4 billion of payments for a local authority contract with a capital value, presiding officer, of just £3.27 billion.
And supplementary, Fossil Chaudhry.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I recently attended an event hosted by COSLA and discussed priorities that were set out in their 5 years plan in 2022. This includes securing sustainable funding, delivering a just transition, and supporting the most vulnerable in our communities. Given the financial pressure being faced by our council, can the Minister advise what measures the Scottish Government is taking to ensure these goals are met?
Minister.
The member for his question, and this is certainly an area that the Scottish Government are working constructively with COSLA on. No one is coming here suggesting that there are not pressures on local governments' finances, just the same as there are right across the public service. That's why this government took decisions to increase the amount of spending power the government had, and I would hope progressive colleagues across the parliament would continue to support those kind of policies to make sure we can prioritise public services over the kind of tax cuts that the Conservative Government.
Question number four, Lee MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of the Ferries Task Force with Orkney Islands Council, including when it expects new ferries to be procured.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Deputy First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Transport met with the new Deputy Leader of Orkney Islands Council on the 18th of April, and they reiterated the Scottish Government's commitment to support the Council in their work to develop a robust business case for the ferry replacement, which can then inform the Council's decisions on their next steps. It was also confirmed in that meeting that the Scottish Government have maintained almost £16 million worth of support for the operation of Orkney's ferries in 2024-25 in a very challenging financial context. And there was also that we're also continuing to provide additional island cost emergency funding to the Council this year as well.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? When the previous First Minister stood down last year, the work of the Ferries Task Force came to an abrupt halt for around 6 months. Given the urgent need to move ahead with procurement of new vessels to operate the lifeline routes in Orkney, can the Minister guarantee that the latest departure from Bute House won't result in the Ferries Task Force being stuck in dry dock again for the remainder of the year?
Minister.
I can absolutely confirm to the member that the work is progressing at pace, and if at such time he wants to come and have an update, a briefing with myself or with the Transport Secretary, I'd be more than happy to oblige.
Supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The National Shipbuilding Strategy Refresh in 2022 outlined a 30-year pipeline of all public sector vessel procurements and committed to having a minimum 10% weighting on social value for all new vessel competitions. Can the Minister confirm that in the case of this programme, will the Government adhere to the 10% minimum threshold in social value and perhaps even go further and be more ambitious as Maritime UK has called for?
Minister.
I have to say that's a question that the Transport Secretary will write to the member with an answer to.
Question number five, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government what the implications are for future tax revenue of reports that the economic recovery outlook for Scotland continues to lag behind the UK average.
Deputy First Minister.
Despite being tied to the failing UK economic model, the Scottish economy, far from lagging behind the UK, is one of the best performing parts of the UK. Scotland, unlike the UK, has avoided entering recession in 2023. Earnings in Scotland grew by 8% in 2023, faster than any other part of the UK, including London and the South East. And income tax revenues are growing faster in Scotland than the rest of the UK.
Douglas Lumsden.
The latest Scottish Government report shows that growth in Scotland's economy for 2025 is expected to be 1.1%, while in the rest of the UK, growth is expected to be nearly double that. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this failure by the Scottish Government will mean an even bigger black hole for our budget in future years? And what actions are the devolved government taking to have growth levels comparable with the rest of the UK?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I know that the Conservatives find it difficult to welcome any good news about the Scottish economy. In my initial remarks, I laid out some of the areas that the Scottish economy is outperforming the UK in terms of strong earnings growth, record income tax receipts, We are absolutely aware of the need for our economy to grow. Scotland's GDP, of course, per capita has grown faster than the UK's since 2007, and since 2007 productivity has grown at an annual average rate of 1% a year in Scotland, compared to the UK's 0.4% a year. And of course, inward investment projects in Scotland have grown quicker than have grown by 3.3% compared to a 6.4% fall across the UK. We absolutely want to make sure that we have a growing economy, and we have strength in many areas, not least in net zero. It's just a pity that the Conservatives continue to talk down the Scottish economy.
Question number six, Jimmy Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has undertaken of how income tax divergence has impacted or may impact private sector recruitment.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Our tax policies are grounded in evidence, and we regularly monitor data on the tax base throughout the year, as well as engaging with business organisations to understand the trading conditions they face. Latest data from HMRC show that the number of payrolled employees in Scotland has grown to a near record high, while separate HMRC research has recently shown that Scotland has attracted thousands of taxpayers from the rest of the UK since 2017-18. This is helping contribute to record income tax receipts, with Scottish income tax now forecast to raise around £18.8 billion in 2024-25.
Jamie Green.
Of course, the Minister is keen to quote figures which are 4 years out of date. Since then, of course, we've seen massive tax hikes in Scotland. He talks about evidence and data. Well, here's some evidence and data. The data says that if you earn £50,000 or more in Scotland, you will pay 20% more tax than any other part of the UK. It's not a sustainable position that is not affecting the private sector's ability to recruit. Every commentator says it. The IOD, the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, the Scottish Financial Enterprise, even the Scottish Fiscal Commission itself is warning of tax divergence and its effect on recruitment. So will the Minister not accept that business is telling us and telling the government that increased tax levels in Scotland are hammering their ability to recruit well-paid jobs here in Scotland?
Minister.
Well, let me start with a point of consensus. I think it's exceptionally important to engage with business, to work with business constructively in our shared endeavour for economic growth. But let me just say where I take a slightly different view. The most recent data that we have is for 21-22, and that shows net positive migration to Scotland across all income tax bands. That is the most recent data that we have to make an assumption on. The second point I would make to the member is this. It is important to look holistically in the round. For example, the significant divergence in average property prices in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK, the significant difference in average council tax compared to the rest of the UK. And if a young professional is so fortunate to be in a position where they are earning £50,000 a year and they have been through an undergraduate university course in Scotland, unlike their counterparts in England, they're not going to be carrying the better part of £30,000 worth of tuition fee debt. So across a range of measures, we use our progressive income tax policies in Scotland to deliver not only a competitive environment, but the best social contract on offer anywhere in these islands.
And a brief supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Opposition members often highlight concerns about potential impact of Scotland's progressive tax system. Can the Minister say any more about what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the recent HMRC research, which indicates that thousands more taxpayers moved to Scotland than left each year in the period after Scottish income tax was introduced?
Minister.
The reality is, ever since income tax was first devolved, opposition parties have claimed that even the slightest policy divergence would lead to an exodus from Scotland. Recent HMRC research dispels that. Growing numbers of taxpayers are leaving the rest of the UK for Scotland, with net inflows averaging 4,200 each year between 2017-18 and 21-22. In the last available year of data, taxable income grew by around £200 million due to this movement of taxpayers. I'll leave it to others in this Parliament to explain how slashing taxes and running down public services would make Scotland a more attractive place to live.
Question number seven, Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether it has funded local government adequately to deliver the services that it is responsible for.
Minister Jo Fitzpatrick.
Thank the member for her question. The Scottish Government recognises the challenging financial circumstances that local authorities and indeed the entire public sector are currently facing. These challenges were considered and reflected in the Local Government Finance Settlement, which provides local authorities with record funding of over £14 billion in 2024-25, a real terms increase of 2.55% compared with the previous year. It is then the responsibility of individual local authorities to manage their own budgets and to allocate the total financial resource available to them on the basis of local needs and priorities.
Karen Wilkin.
Now, I thank the Minister for that answer. Councils and residents in my region of South Scotland and beyond are feeling the true impact of successive SNP budgets, of course backed up by the Greens, that have taken the axe to council funding and services. Does the Minister understand the level of cuts in local authorities imposed by his government to the poorest communities in Scotland? And is it not the case that Scotland is now suffering from two out-of-touch, out-of-road governments, and they would be far better off without them?
Minister.
No, I don't agree. We just heard about the levels of local authorities having to serve Section 114 notices in the rest of the UK, where the Scottish National Party is not in government. But let me just talk about the rises that have come to the members south of Scotland region. Dumfries and Galloway, 5.7% increase compared to 23-24. East Ayrshire, 5.2%. East Lothian, 8.5% compared to 23-24. I see time is running. Scottish Borders, 6.2% increase, presiding officer. South Ayrshire Council, 6.7% increase compared to the 23-24 budget. And Midlothian Council, 7.6% increase compared to the 23-24 budget. We all recognise these are challenging times for everyone in public service, but it's absolutely clear that this Scottish Government has prioritised the local services and local government to the best of our ability.
I have two requests for supplementaries. I intend to take both members, but they will need to be brief. Liz Smith.
The Scottish Government made a commitment last year via the Verity House Agreement that it would introduce multi-year funding for council budgets, and Shirley Ann Somerville made that commitment for the voluntary sector in November. Can I ask again when that's going to happen?
Minister.
The member does not find any division across the chamber, I don't think, about the importance of multi-year budgeting, but it is absolutely impossible with the volatility of the current system, where the UK budget comes so late in the year for us and comes with no certainty, no multi-year aspect to that, for us to do that. But it's absolutely something that this government would want to take forward, but it's something we need to take forward in partnership with local government and, of course, in partnership with the UK government.
And brief supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With the Scottish Government providing a record funding of over £14 billion, local authorities, as just been said, can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding the work underway to empower local government, including a new fiscal framework?
Minister.
Thank you. Thank the member for the question. Work on the fiscal framework is really important to the Scottish Government in terms of their collaboration with COSLA. It's something that is being taken forward with a close working with COSLA to agree a local framework. We published an update just last December, and we will be working for the fiscal framework, subject to those collaborations, to be in place in advance of the 25-26 Scottish budget.
And question number 8, Ash Regan.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it still plans to deliver the shared policy programme contained within the Bute House Agreement in light of reports that many of its policies have been discarded.
Deputy First Minister.
The Bute House Agreement played a central role in our aim of building a greener, fairer and independent Scotland. It made possible a number of achievements, including delivering a progressive budget that prioritised the NHS and public services over tax cuts, free bus travel for under-22s, bringing ScotRail into public ownership and committing the first £75 million of the 10-year Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray. But for the reasons set out by the First Minister last Thursday, the First Minister took the decision to end the Bute House Agreement. Any policy decisions will be notified to Parliament in the normal manner.
Ash Regan.
What is the point of the First Minister
dramatically chucking the Greens out of the front door, only for the next one to sneak them in round the back.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, this government will get on with governing as a minority government, and of course in doing so we will reach out to those who share our progressive values, who want to work with us in a constructive manner, and that will be the case for the opposition parties across the whole of this parliament. The question for them is, can they rise to the occasion?
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on finance, Deputy First Minister responsibilities and parliamentary business. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.